So we started the Planet Hunters project in 2010. And what happened was that as soon as we saw the data that was released by the NASA Kepler mission, we realized that this would be a perfect project for citizen scientists. So the Planet Hunters project shows a little bit of data measuring the brightness of a star in the Kepler field. And the Planet Hunters users, who are volunteers from all over the world, look at the light curves and they try to see if there's a little dip in the brightness of the star. And if there is, they click on that spot, and that information is stored in a database, and it allows the science team to extract the transits and model them and find planets orbiting other stars. So this is, I think, a really fun project because it gives volunteers, citizen scientists around the world, a chance to actually be planet hunters, to go out and find new worlds. The transit technique is a method for finding planets, and that's the type of data that's shown on Planet Hunters. And what happens is, if you have, imagine that you have a nice bright star and you're looking at it, and then a planet goes in front of the star. So when that happens, depending on how big the planet is, it will block out some of the starlight. If the planet's very small, then it just blocks out a tiny bit of light. So if you're looking at the brightness of the star, you see a tiny dip in the brightness until the planet finishes its orbit across the face of the star. And if the planet's very big, then the dip is much larger. And so that fact allows us to measure the size of planets orbiting other stars. That's one of the most important techniques for finding planets. Another technique is the Doppler technique. And this is something that the professional astronomers do at the observatory using instruments that are called spectrometers. The spectrometers look at the light from the star and they measure the wavelength shift that occurs because of something called the Doppler effect. So when the star is moving towards you, the light from the star turns a little bit bluer. And when the star is moving away from you, the light turns a little bit redder. And so if there's a planet orbiting the star, then there's a periodic process where the star comes toward us and then goes away from us. And we measure that night after night at the telescopes, at professional observatories. And that's another way of finding planets. That's a technique that I've used for more than 15 years now, and it's been really successful at finding planets. But the very best thing is to be able to combine both the transit technique, which gives you the size of the planet, and the Doppler technique, which gives you the mass of the planet. Because when you do that, you can calculate mass over volume, which is the density of the planet, and you can figure out if it's a gas giant planet or if it's a small rocky planet. So that's a pretty cool science to be able to pull out about planets that we can't even see, that are orbiting stars that are 100 light years away. I think the main reason that we're looking for planets is that we're curious about whether or not there's life elsewhere. There are other reasons to look for planets too. We want to understand how our solar system came into existence and whether or not it's typical, whether other stars have planetary systems that are like our own. But really, I think most of us want to find out if there's life around other planets. So if we find them, that's the very first step, is to imagine finding them. And at that point, we really don't know what that life will be like. We don't know if we'll be able to communicate with it at all. So it's kind of hard to imagine what we might say if we actually came face to face with creatures from another planet, or even just looked at and realized that they were far away. I guess for me, the very first step is just first find the planets, then figure out if there's life there. Is it plant life, or is it animal life, or is it life that's more sophisticated and maybe technological? And so as we learn those things, we'll figure out, you know, what are the important questions to ask them about. A lot of people, when I describe the research of finding exoplanets, then will say, okay, that's nice, but what's the practical significance? What really, why is this important? And I think When you ask that question, you're thinking your view of yourself and the world is just this, you know, is concentrated on this tiny little planet. And if you step back and you think this tiny little planet is just one planet orbiting a star, an ordinary star, and that star is, there are billions of other stars in our Milky Way galaxy, billions of other galaxies in the universe, then you get a perspective of really how tiny we are. But despite the fact that we're incredibly tiny, we're also pretty amazing, because on our planet there have been many other species that have lived and have died, and we are the only species to develop technology to build observatories that look up and figure out that the universe came to into existence with a Big Bang. We figured out that every atom in our body was once in the core of a star. We wouldn't be here without the processes that we study in astronomy. So I think, you know, looking for life elsewhere, looking for planets elsewhere, is really just a way of trying to figure out where we fit in the whole universe. But it's also an effort to try and ensure our long-term survival, because there are a lot of challenges. If we think about the species that have gone extinct, like the dinosaurs that went extinct after an asteroid collided with the Earth, we're a species that will be able to monitor near-Earth asteroids and maybe do something about it. So I see astronomy as a vision plan for humanity. And if you have a really great business, then most of the time you have to worry about how to make a profit, how to make the business successful. But, you know, the very best businesses also look at the big picture and figure out where they fit in. And so I think astronomy does that for humanity. What kind of problems are you trying to solve? Okay. The whole field of exoplanets is actually a brand new field. So we are just beginning to understand, first of all, that other stars have planets. That's something we didn't know 20 years ago. And now we're trying to figure out if there are other planets like our Earth are common, and whether or not planets that are like our Earth are likely to form life. So I think those are the really big problems that we're trying to address. And the great thing about science is that the questions and the problems never end. Once we answer those questions, there will be 100 new questions right behind it. I think this is a very exciting time to study what we call exoplanets, planets around other stars, because it's a baby field. It's just starting. And that means that the number of discoveries are going to be incredible. So it's a really great field for young people to get involved in. And I think it's, even if you're not a scientist, it's just really cool to understand this big picture of where we fit in. I love talking to students, undergraduates and graduate students. They always teach me more, or as much, I think, as I teach them. A lot of times, what I like best is that the questions that they ask, they almost always think, this is going to be a stupid question. But usually the questions that they ask will be asked in a way that I haven't thought about the problem before. And it's like when you're looking at a puzzle. If you can turn the puzzle around, right, the object around, you really begin to understand it that way. And so that's what students do for me. I have a picture of the way I think things are, and students ask me a question, and it makes me sort of turn and look at things in a new way. And so that's the really exciting thing, is that when I work with students, I'm always learning. I started working on the search for exoplanets in 1997, and most of the people, even astronomers, they thought our data were really nice, really beautiful data, but they didn't believe that we were finding planets. They thought maybe there could be other things going on that would cause the star to produce the velocity changes that we saw. And people said, you know, well, if you find a star that has more than one planet, then we'll be a little more confident that these are really planets. Or if you find a planet that transits in front of its star, then we'll believe that really these are planets. And so that happened in 1999. Both of those discoveries were made. And I remember it was my job. I was a postdoctoral fellow in 1999, and I was modeling, creating a mathematical model to fit our data. And I think my boss had basically told me, you know, we found one planet in the system. We think there's a second one. It's your job to create a mathematical model that fits the data. And I couldn't do it. And the reason was that there were actually three planets in the system. So when I added the third planet and saw this gorgeous fit, you know, all of a sudden I realized, wait, that's three planets that are the size of Jupiter in our solar system, or even bigger. And they orbit all, you know, at sort of, one was in a four-day orbit, one was in an orbit that's like Venus's orbit, and the other one was in an orbit that's about 2 years, so a little bit longer than the Earth, the Earth's orbit. But it was hard to imagine having three giant planets all packed into this system. So the first thing I realized is that this process of planet formation must be very efficient around other stars. And so that was, I just remember walking across from my office to my boss's office to show him the model and looking at the data and thinking a couple of things. First of all, this is something that no human being has ever seen before. I'm the first person in the world, in all of time, to see this, and that's the cool thing about science. And then second, that this process of planet formation is a very robust process. So it was a pretty amazing day. And it was also right about that time in 1999 that, you know, I had been hearing talks from biologists, and the biologists were saying, wherever we find water on this planet, we find life. Whether you're deep underneath the surface of the Earth, whether you're in an acidic, you know, lake where we couldn't live, these extremophiles on our planet, what we call extremophiles, life in extreme environments, really seem to thrive. And so life gets going. Life is a robust process. And thinking of those two things, you know, planet formation is a robust process. Life is a robust process on planets. And putting those two ideas together and imagining that, you know, it's hard for me to, it was hard for me to imagine that there would be other worlds and that there wouldn't be life on some of those other worlds. I think the coolest thing about my work is the ability to discover new things, things that no one's ever known before, and to know that I'm contributing one little piece of a giant puzzle that humanity is trying to figure out. And also a sense of collaboration with other human beings in the world, that this is something that we all pull together and we create something that's incredibly magnificent. You know, again, I think back to the dinosaurs who roamed the Earth for millions of years. You know, they've been here, they were here much longer than we've been here. And yet they didn't know that, you know, that there was a Big Bang. They didn't know about star formation. They didn't know that there had been other species of life. And so I think it's amazing that as human beings that we can do this. Day in my life, in my work life, isn't like that. Every moment, unfortunately, isn't filled with new discoveries. There's a lot of work developing computer codes, collecting observations, making sure that all of the observations and the interpretation are statistically correct. But then there are these, you know, that's interspersed with these moments of discovery and realization that are really, really fun. So if I had just one thing to tell other people about my work, I guess it would be that science is amazing, that we get to discover new things, and that the discoveries in astronomy really provide a vision of where we fit in. And I think it unites us as a species, this sort of quest for understanding our curiosity. That wasn't the best one, but anyway. When I was a kid, I loved science fiction books. So I would sort of sit up in the tree and read my science fiction books and imagine that someday I would be a scientist. And of course, when I was 12 or 13 years old, I didn't know what that would exactly mean. I think I pictured myself in the basement of an old dungeon, with test tubes of smoking chemicals and making things explode and creating Frankenstein-like things. But I always wanted to be a scientist, and I just thought it was, it's an adventure. It's a real adventure of discovery, and I've loved that my whole life. So I've read books by Robert Heinlein, Isaac Asimov, lots of science fiction writers in the past, and now the science that we're discovering has sort of taken the place of that science fiction in my life. So they're real discoveries.